I'm Ryan Hurd, songwriter in Nashville, Tennessee, RCA recording artist, and this is Panoramic. I started creating music when I was a kid, and I remember I learned how to play guitar when I was probably 11 years old. Played my uncle's acoustic guitar and learned D chord. But I think where I got really excited about it was high school. I went to high school with a guy who's still my producer, Aaron, and we just started writing songs together, and we played a couple shows as a band. And then when I got to Nashville, I did school. I went to Belmont, and I did not do music really in college very much. I was in a band for a second, but when I graduated and kind of saw what songwriting in Nashville was, is when I got really excited about it and said I wanted to try to be really serious about it and see if I could make a go of it. And so I signed my first publishing deal and became a professional songwriter at 2012. I decided I wanted to make music a career just when I saw like the ecosystem of music grow. And I found out that you could be a songwriter as a profession, and not just like, you didn't have to be the artist, you could be behind the scenes and be creative in that way. So it was sort of like I saw a job that I wanted to do, and I figured out a way to become that. It took a few years, but you know, it's been a really exciting thing. I love the people in that community. I love just Nashville. I think it's the greatest music town in the world. When I started doing this, I remember being at a bar and telling my now publisher, Alex Heddle, that if I could just have one, I just had one hit, it's all I need. I said, just all I, and he laughed at me, and he said, yeah, then you'll want another. And he was right, but I think like when you're starting out, just having one big hit is sort of like the thing that you're looking for. But I just remember also, like, I've done a really good job of kind of putting, like, doing one thing at a time. And so I, like, when I started writing, I was like, we just gotta figure out a way to get a publishing deal. So, like, getting that first publishing deal was like, we made it. And then it's like, I just gotta get my first cut. And the first person to record my music was Jake Owen. Like, getting that phone call was like, that's the one, you made it, you know? And then it's like, oh, your first single. So, like, you're sort of always, that's the thing about doing music, is like there's always another thing, there's always like a carrot that you're chasing. So I don't know, I think that like the reward for this, more so than actual success, is like getting it, being able to do it. Like every time you have a hit, it means you get to write songs for 2 or 3 more years, you know what I mean? And so that to me is like, the work is its own reward. Co-writing is interesting. Like, choosing your co-writers is when you're younger and you just, like, you're newer and you're just sort of figuring it out, you write so many songs with so many different people that, like, you have a say in who you're writing with, but you cast such a wide net. And I think the more you do it and the more success you have, you sort of pinpoint who you, like, write your best material with and who you're most comfortable with and who you think can take an idea you have and make it special. And so I think the more you do it, the smaller your circle gets. And some people are the opposite. Like, there's writers who, the more they write, like, they want to write with every new kid in town. And like Craig Wiseman's a good example. He will write with anybody once. And but I've found that like the less I write, the better the songs are. And the less I, like, the smaller my circle is, the more comfortable I am and with just being open. And I don't ever have days where I'm looking at the calendar being like, I don't know about that one. Like, I really do value like keeping my circle tight. I think the thing about music and creativity is like, it is, you're waking up every day and you're showing up to try to catch lightning in a bottle. And I think that the more people that you have in your circle that are on that same page with you, the better. And you know, I think about someone like Laura Veltz or like Aaron Esais or even Marin, where like I know that I can bring them my best idea and they will treat it with respect and they'll put everything they have into it. And like, I also think about like how they evolve. It's just there's a comfort level there that is, I think there's some, it's pretty understandable why. I mean, you songwriting is a very intimate thing, and the more people that you can, I guess, the more comfortable you are, like, that's like fertile soil for something to blossom in a cool way. And so I think those relationships, honestly, like my best friends right now in my life, my whole, like everything I have in my life is from songs, including my best friendships. And so, yeah, I mean, I think that those are the people that you share, like not just like your creative hopes and dreams with. It's like you share your life with those people. And, you know, you kind of like go through a therapy session every single time that like something big happens. And I just have really, I think that like aside from the fact that it's like a living and it's exciting and you're building a career, you're also like building amazing relationships. And that's been such an amazing part of my life that I don't think I saw like happening like at the, when I started out. Cole and I signed with the same publisher right around the same time. So I was writing at Universal Music Publishing, and Cole came in just after I did, and immediately just we started writing some songs, and it's really fun. The other guy, Chase McGill, also signed right around the time that we did, and so the three of us were kind of the new guys at this really successful publisher, and we each like started having success like separately and together, and like we just always wrote great songs together. And a lot of times the new guys at a publishing company get just automatically paired together, and there was a little bit of that happening. And but like Cole had put out an EP or two, and I had a song on that, and so we just were really just easy. Like sometimes when you write songs, somebody just comes easily, and he's a great lyricist, and I value that so much in my collaborators, just because like lyrics are the hardest part. No matter what you're doing, like it doesn't matter how the sound changes or what equipment you're using, or if you're just writing on guitars, like everybody needs words. So when you find somebody who is where the words come easy, it's really a valuable thing. And that's like Cole. And with Nathan, I met through Marin, because he was subbing on a couple like gigs. He used to play guitar for Katy Perry, and he would sub on a couple. I don't even know like why he was subbing, but he was out a couple times with her, and he had been playing with Katy Perry, and he was like trying to get off the road. So he had been like kind of getting his feet wet with writing songs in Nashville. And I just remember one day like looking at our manager Janet being like, I gotta write some songs with Nathan. Like, I don't know the vibe, like the dude just has a vibe. And you walk into his studio and he's all about like analog synths, and all of his song starts from a production standpoint were just so different. And I just immediately, for whatever reason, just started like making cool stuff with Nathan, and wrote To a T with him and Laura, wrote Platonic with Nathan. Like all those like weird, like kind of like artist defining sonic like moments have been like Nathan and Aaron.
Hey y'all, I'm Cole Taylor. I'm a songwriter at Universal Music Publishing Group here in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm from Cuthbert, Georgia, and I am one of the co-writers on Ryan Hurd's single, Every Other Memory, and it's one of my favorite songs I've ever written, and I am proud to be a part of it.
Every Other Memory was cool. I think Cole had the title, but Nathan also had that song start. He had the initial like intro guitar lick on loop, and I think that it was relatively quick. It was just kind of, it felt just like we were all on the same page immediately.
Mm-hmm. I think when Nathan had that track kind of going, it felt so reminiscent and so reflective of the guitar lick, and everything felt like a memory. And then I was scrolling down so far in my notes, and I was like, oh, here's a cool title, like Every Other Memory. And I was like, I don't know what this means. And then I think you were like, Every Other Memory is you. And we're like, oh, that's the cool thing, the way to turn it.
The cool part about a song like that is like when you talk about every other memory, you can sort of just start putting pictures in there and tying rhymes together in a cool way. And so, like, you know, talking about like going to a race or that whole, and like sometimes like tying a rhyme together like makes the rest of the song make mm-hmm. sense. And so when you said like that wrapped around your shoulder that whole October, it was like a simple thing in your mind, you don't realize how good it is, and then like you kind of listen to it back and you're like, that's it. And so like I feel like once we got like some of the pictures down, it sort of like let the whole rest of the puzzle come together. With this song, it was relatively quick. Sometimes it takes me 4 months to finish a song. I remember when I wrote Michigan for the Winter with Aaron and Neil, I just couldn't really get all the pieces to work together, so I had to keep rewriting it. And with this song, when Cole said the title, it fell out and we sort of got like a couple of the pictures in place, it sort of made the rest of the song make sense. And it was like all about nostalgia, and it really did come together relatively quickly. And Nathan's such a great producer, and he turns the demo around. And so like when you're excited about a song and the demo comes back and you can listen to it pretty quickly, like that's mm-hmm. when you're like, okay, that's when you can really get excited about it, because it's still fresh on your mind and your heart. And so like this was one of those tunes that just, I knew immediately, like, that's, I'm not letting anybody hear this one yet. And I put it in my back pocket for a year or whatever, and then got an opportunity to record it.
In general, I think every day is different. I think some days you kind of find that lightning in the bottle, and some days you just...
doing your job.
Yeah, you just, it feels like a job some days, and you banging your head against the wall and figuring out why you're writing songs. And some days are magic and you're like, this is why I moved to Nashville to write songs like this. And
I felt like that with this song. It was like, that's why, that's worth like all the last 10 songs I don't care about.
Yeah, you have to get through the bad ones to find the great ones. And yeah, this is one of those great ones that it might have taken us, we've written so many songs together, and this was the one that was
the most special.
Yeah.
Songwriting ideas are crazy because they're literally just like a list of things that could maybe be a song. And so mm-hmm. Cole just had it in his ideas, in his notes, in his his song ideas, and he just threw it out there. But so like Cole's idea, but you don't know it. Like it happens every day where you're like, I have this, I don't know what to do with it. It's not an idea until everybody gets it and they're like...
Yeah, I almost had a title.
Yeah.
I didn't really have an idea.
The idea comes when you're like, what could that be? And that's like where the, like, sort of the collective unconscious comes in, where you're like, I see this story or I see this angle. And that's, I think, why co-writing is so special. Mm-hmm. I feel like anytime I can be in the room with Nathan or be in the room with Cole, look forward to it, which is really important. And I also am gonna walk away with something that I will want to play in my car. And so, like, there's so many people in Nashville that can write a hit song, but it's all about writing your hit song. It's mm-hmm. like writing a thing that makes you, like, as an artist, like, believable. Like, and so, anytime I can be in the room with Nathan or Cole, it's, I think what, you know, guys like Luke. Having like Michael Carter around, or Eric Church having Luke Dick, or who writes Eric Church songs?
Casey Bethard,
yeah. Those dudes, like, I have a group of people that I think of as my Casey Bethards and my Michael Carters, and like guys that like I can lean on if I need something, you know? And so that's just a mindset that is priceless. You can't force that or manufacture it. It's just comes with time and being creative for and comfortable with somebody for long enough. I feel like the reason that people like me fit so well in the South is because like I grew up on a lake, and like Michigan is such like a mix of like rural and Rust Belt,
mm-hmm.
where like somebody from Georgia can go there and be like, this feels really familiar.
Yeah.
So we can talk about the same things. Like when I wrote. We both have Luke Bryan hits. When I wrote mine, it was amazing because like all of those pictures in my head on Sunrise, Sunburn, Sunset, those were Michigan pictures in my mind, and some dude from Georgia takes it and he's like, this is, like, he saw, you know, himself in that. It's just crazy how like writing country music is sort of like there's this like universal quality to it, for like, doesn't matter like where you're from in America, you can find things that like you can pinpoint in country music that you can like kind of grab on and make your own. You know what I think is cool about writing songs is like, there's a very real, there's a difference between real and true. Like I'm lucky because as an artist, I've gotten to put out a lot of autobiographical music. Like I get put out Love in a Bar, that's my story. Diamonds Are Twine, that's literally my story. Like even to a T is like, everybody knows like what the muse is, and this is very like true to whatever. This is the one that I put out that I think is the most accessible because it's not just my story. And in my mind, all those pictures are one relationship that, you know, I've borrowed from my own life and Cole's borrowed from his own life. And we've created a story that I think is absolutely real, even if it's not true. You know what I'm saying? Like there's a, like it becomes real when the listener hears it and they internalize it and they find things that they make their own. But true and, you know, collect, are the stories real? Like, yeah, they're real stories. They're real things that people do. They're real things they put in their memory bank that they always go back to. And that's like what nostalgia is. And that's, nobody does nostalgia like we do in country music.
For me, like with country music and with every other memory specifically, I kind of go back to like Anything But Mine, the Kenny Chesney song. It's like one of my favorite country songs ever.
Mm-hmm.
And I see those pictures and I've always wanted to make somebody feel the way I felt when I heard that song in the beginning. And I feel like this song with all the pictures and stuff, like, I mean, you put it in a great way. Is it true? Maybe not, but is it real?
Hell yeah.
That's definitely happened for somebody in this world.
Or pieces of it have.
And people can see themselves in any of those pictures in that song. And that's kind of what Anything But Mine did. It's like, have I been through that? Anything But Mine? Maybe in some parts, but not everyone, but I could put myself in that, in any situation in that song.
Like that created, that song created a subgenre of country music, like beach music.
Yeah.
And I don't know, this, I think.
And I don't know that I was like comparing to.
No,
I
think it's a
good,
cool comparison. I think it is. I think it's like attempting to be that for somebody. And like, that is a really like good comparison just as far as the type of song it is and what you're trying to achieve with the listener.
Right.
Like I want you to put yourself, I want you to see every single moment that is being talked about here. I want it to be visual. Yes. I don't want it to just be something that you like hear and you're like, that sounds cool. That sounds like it. Cause there's so many songs you're just like, that sounds cool. That sounds like a hit. But when you can put yourself there in your mind and you see every picture, that's a massive deal.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Catherine, and my question is about writer's block. So I went into quarantine with the intention of writing a lot and trying to get a lot of songs down, but I'm finding that the ideas are just not flowing as readily as I'd hoped. And I'm really finding myself sitting here and waiting for the inspiration to come to me rather than just trying to work through this period of writer's block. So because your songs are just so thoughtful and intentional, I'm wondering if you have any specific tools or strategies that you use to generate ideas and elaborate on them throughout the songwriting process when you're not feeling particularly inspired.
Writer's block is tough. I think that you sort of, the more that you treat this like a job, the less you end up working with it. I think writer's block is two things. It's perspective and it's craft. And I think the more you can sort of develop a worldview and also practice the craft of songwriting, the less you'll be dealing with writer's block. And that's also why co-writing is really cool. Is like you can have a slow week, but if your co-writer's on fire, then you get to like help them create something special. And I think collaborating is a really great idea, a great way to kind of move beyond those moments of when you don't feel creative. And so, I mean, the more you do this, the less you find writer's block to be an issue because you're leaning on craft more than inspiration. And you're also like around other people who are creative who aren't, you don't have to carry the entire creative burden. And so, you know, it's a difficult and a lonely place to be, to feel like you can't write something great. But just writing anything, honestly, is a helpful thing to like move beyond those moments.
Hi, my name is Nicholas Studer, and I'm actually moving down to Nashville in September. And one thing I was wondering can relate to myself, but I think a lot of other artists out there can relate as well. And that question is just, what is some advice you would give to really make yourself stand out from the competition? The pool's massive, and there's a lot of people out there chasing their musical dreams. And what is just some tips that you would give when entering a city to really make your work stand out and get recognized?
What are some tips moving to Nashville? Well, first of all, half the battle is moving to Nashville. If you want to write music in this genre, it's kind of hard to do it from somewhere else. But I think that like viewing other people around you as competition is probably something that's probably wouldn't be my perspective. I would say that like the people around you are potential collaborators and people to learn from. And you know, you're gonna find your tribe of writers that you're gonna come up with. And I think a lot of times people chase co-writes with people with publishing deals or with people who have hit songs, and when they should be chasing their best music. And so I always tell people when they're moving to Nashville or they wanna start doing this to focus on getting better instead of getting somewhere. Because at some point, if you work on your craft and it grows, there's gonna be no way to deny you. The music will be too good for someone to say no. And that's the point I think that everybody gets to. And it might take a second to figure that out. And you'll figure out how to network and how to find people to write songs with. But you'll find that like the more you start co-writing with people, if it gets better, like your crew will all sort of grow together and have success together. And like I still write with Aaron Esice, and he produces all my music. And I've known him since I was 14 years old or 11 years old or whatever the number is. And so like, those are the people you're gonna have the most success with. So find your tribe, focus on getting better and not getting somewhere, and that's a really good start. Hey, thank you to CMAEDU for sending all of your questions. It was amazing to answer them. Good luck to all of you in your country music journey. I'm Ryan Hurd, and this was Panoramic.